Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here. I saw some of the first session and then ran upstairs for my session and then I'm back here. But I've been hearing great things already. Let me talk to you a little bit about Liru in order to make my case about why this is important. Liru stands for League of European Research Universities. We are a network of 23 leading research-intensive universities in Europe. The reason we are there is to help form policies about higher education and research in Europe and to be active in Brussels in the EU policy making, especially on research issues, and also to weigh on the funding program of the European Commission currently, Horizon 2020. Talking about the points that I'd like to make in this first introduction is really about the benefits and the need and the power for working together as an association, as a network of universities, the benefits of advocacy and the need to do that, and to finally also make the point that there are three fixes needed. So to start with the first one, let me go back to 2010. My leadership and I had a meeting with the just-appointed Commissioner for Research and Innovation, Mary Gagan Quinn, Commissioner for Research and Innovation. And we did our spiel about why universities are important, what we want to achieve at the European level. And she said, very kindly, "That's all grand, but what are you doing about gender?" And we stood there looking at each other, and we really didn't have a good answer. So, not very long afterwards, we started a working group on gender, of course. So I shared this story with you to show the power that individuals in leadership roles can make to advance things. It was really taken up by the rectors, vice rectors, senior leaders at the Liru universities to do something about it. We've now had a working group on gender for almost 7 years, and it's been a very active and successful and productive group. They meet about twice a year. They're usually either vice rectors with the responsibility for gender equality and sometimes also diversity, and or the heads of the equality offices. And I can't tell you how important it is that these people meet around a table. One of the reasons that we're small, only 23 universities, is that we can meet face to face and exchange experiences. And some of these offices or activities in the universities are very well resourced and others are not. So you have anything from a gender champion or individual vice rector with not a lot of resources trying to change things at their universities to a very well resourced, money-wise, staff-wise university. And the people really benefit from talking to each other, talking about each other's challenges and say, how do you approach this? What are your possible solutions for that? I can't say how important that is. It's also important for me because I sit there as the officer within Liru trying to advance this, taking this up for the policy making at the European level. And it has led, it's important that the leadership, and this is the point, one of the points in our first paper that we did on 2012, that the leadership is firmly behind this agenda. And this agenda, gender agenda, needs to be a real agenda, not just, we have a gender strategy, we have a gender action plan. It actually needs to translate into concrete actions. And that's one of the important roles that we as a network try to support our universities for doing that. In addition to the first paper that was produced in 2012, we have also looked at the issue of the gender dimension in research content, as it's called in EU speak, or the sex gender-based analysis, as you call it, or the GRI, gendered research and innovation, as we call it. It's not an easy one to find a sort of acronym that everybody agrees on for that. But that also is an area of need at the European policy paper, policy making. And we're currently also looking at the selection processes and the bias in the selection, appointment, recruitment processes at the universities, because I'm personally convinced that there's a lot of work to be done. Success rates, whether it's in funding or in appointments, even if there are small differences between men and women, and sometimes people say those differences are small, I don't think we can discard it, and we have to do a lot more in terms of making sure that those success rates are equal and making sure that the applicant pool is bigger. So, and finally, in terms of the three fixes needed, I think it's very important for universities to realize the three fixes, as Londa Schiebinger has proposed them, that it's not about the women, it's about fixing the numbers of the women, and it's about fixing the institutions. And finally, it's also about fixing the knowledge, so addressing the sex and gender based analysis in the research content and the process itself. I think for me, I'm also the policy officer that supports the careers group in our university. So there are a lot of links there that we have to make and learn from each other in terms of what is good for, we can use gender issues, gender actions, gender initiatives as an example, to show the way on how to make better workplaces at universities. We all know there's a lot to be done in order for the university to remain as an attractive workplace for researchers, that they want to pursue careers in research. And actually making progress on the gender issue, because it's good for science, it's good for research, will also help to make us improve the workplace and make the research career attractive.
Spot on time. Dr. Tannenbaum.
Thank you very much. Is this on?
Yep.
I think I shared a lot of my experience and stories, success and some failures with you earlier today. So let me just repeat the three major take-home messages from my learning. That is, there's no management without measurement. So having that data, that question, is there gender bias in all the funding competitions? I learned a lot watching my organization say, well, let's do a deeper dive. You know, numbers speak, but they hide a lot. So it would be false for us to come out and say that the Canadian Institutes of Health Research has gender bias in all its programs. And that would actually undermine a lot of the success that women are having if we did that. So doing this deep dive into the analysis and trying to figure out what exactly the numbers are telling us, I think, was critically important for me. The second thing I've learned is what I said this morning, and I'll say it again, just the power of the funding agency to act as a lever of change by putting pressure on the universities with those chair awards and putting pressure on the investigators who, in many times in the university setting, career advancement is dependent on getting a research award. So, you know, we could definitely use that. The third point was actually made by my colleague from Australia, and that's that I hadn't quite appreciated the power of the media. So if the media gets behind this and celebrates women and points out that we shouldn't be calling them female scientists, and in our case, a lot of the major radio stations interviewed women when the results of the funding competition were unequal, and they were able to call out the university. So ministers and politicians respond to the media more than they respond to our letters or what we say around those tables when we meet with them. And that's just the reality of politics. And, if you haven't, what's that expression? If you've turned establishment by the time you're 30, you have no heart. And if you haven't turned establishment after 30, you have no brain. So I didn't want to believe that we had to, I don't want to say the word suck up to the ministers, but your point about leadership is you absolutely have to convince the decision makers that this is a priority. And whether it's you or whether it's the media, I would run after that. Do I have any more time?
Yes, you have 3 minutes.
No way. Okay. Yeah. I guess I said most of what I wanted to say this morning. Then I think I would just share some reflections on culture change. And I was going to say I'm not an expert on this, but I recall what you just said, so I won't say that. How do you, it's one thing to write papers, and it's another thing to change the policies and make equity frameworks, but how do you actually change the culture? And here I'm just going to call out and maybe even ask for your advice. What do you do about that person, usually a man, around the table who says, don't you think you're threatening men if you want women to take up more positions? And have you looked at the numbers in medical school classes? There's actually now more women entering medical school classes than men. So I really think you don't have a case and it's going to be just fine in a few years. What do you do about that? What do you do about the people whose eyes glass over when you start to talk and they go, oh, there she goes with her feminist agenda? What are people's tips for dealing with that? One thing I've learned is just to call it out and to say, this is not about a feminist agenda. This is about excellence, rigor, and missed opportunity in science. So call out maybe some of the things that people are whispering. In my case with the researchers, the discovery research, when you say the word gender, they take out their iPhones, really. So what do you do? I sometimes start with questions. So in this sentence, do I mean sex or do I mean gender? And you get them to realize maybe they don't know. And someone taught me to use the word when they say it wrong. You know, is that sex or gender? It's gender. No, actually, it's sex. Mice don't really have gender, so you can't say there's a gender difference in the response to these animals to, I don't know, some kind of chemical. They don't have gender. But then a lot of the men, and this is my struggle. So how do you be gender transformative while still using stereotypes to reach the way people currently think? I don't know if that makes sense to you, but I struggle with that. So a young male researcher, I said, no, you got that question wrong. That's sex, not gender. And he said, oh, rookie mistake. And for those of you in sports, you know, that's okay to be a rookie. This man thought, oh, rookie mistake, okay, good. So I'm learning. So is it okay to say rookie mistake, which is a gendered sports term that men will accept and say, oh, okay, so now I think I understand the difference between sex and gender. I'm going to go tell all my other friends who are making rookie mistakes. Is it okay to use that term? Some people seem to like it, and it gets into their psyche, and it allows them to change, or is that too stereotype? So I think we also struggle with being gender transformative while at the same time calling out some of those stereotypes and the words that we use. People hate the word affirmative action, actually, in Canada. They feel that it diminishes the value of a meritocracy, and that if you were selected based on affirmative action, then why weren't you selected on your merit? So this point about language and what language to use and how to use it and what resonates and what will change culture and move people forward is, I guess, just from a personal level, what I struggle with. And if anyone has any tips or tricks, to please speak now or catch me at the breaks, because I'm really open to hearing what's worked for you. And in the spirit of sharing best practices, I'd like to hear some of your thoughts on that.
And your time is definitely up now. No, it's okay. You're on time. Professor Love.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm very excited to be here. So my role is senior advisor to the provost on women faculty. And this was a position that was created after we had done our own pay equity analysis at UBC, starting about a decade ago, that resulted in a 2% across the board pay raise for women, because after multiple regression analyses, they couldn't account for the discrepancy in pay. University was going to be facing a BC human rights case. And so this position was created basically to have some accountability. Before I get to that, because my position is university-wide, because the provost is, of course, university-wide, I'd also like to mention that my background is in chemistry, so I do come from a STEM field. I'm a professor in the chemistry department. And I'm also here with my colleague, Dr. Carola Hipsch-Yetter, so just put up your hand. So she's seconded 50% to the provost's office, and 50% of her work is in the Faculty of Science. And so we have a poster that may be of interest. So I just want to mention some of the current and upcoming priorities that I've been working on, I'd like to reiterate the point about data-driven analysis. That's what convinces the upper administration to actually implement any sort of a change. And it's what I've noticed in, we also do, I think I could have given Dr. Rodriguez's presentation. We're not quite as far along, but we do a lot of are doing a lot of the same things. That you can convince naysayers. And so maybe this is one of these best practices to share a few things. It takes some time to convince people. They're often defensive initially, but when I've done some equity training for search committees, I've seen people walk in clearly with a chip on their shoulder and walk out with their jaw dropped because of showing them certain graphs. That if they're, not just in science, but anyone doing research, I challenge them to come up with a different explanation. And those people can often become your best supporters because, you know, over the water cooler, they might be saying, oh, I didn't believe it either, but boy, I walked out of there convinced. And that's going to take some time, but I think that's effective. So we're continuing with the pay equity audit because there's some indicators that pay equity issues can creep back in, and so we need to be able to monitor these on a regular basis. Carola and I have been working very hard on what we call the dashboard project, and this is taking human resources data, so it's at present male-female binary, time to tenure, time to promotion from assistant to associate, associate to full, effective leaves, and for the whole university using Tableau, which is a data visualization software, be able to get really quick snapshots of how things are, looking at it the last 5 years. You can set it for 6 to 10, 11 to 15, and so on and so on, and then you can look at a trajectory and do trend line analysis. I was very busy this year, as has happened in many schools in North America, as part of a sexual assault policy development, so I was on the steering committee. We're doing an audit internally of Tri-Council, mainly because of foundation grants, I have to say, and also awards information. And some things that are upcoming that I'm just beginning to start to work on now are mentoring programs. So I saw that there's going to be some discussions of mentoring programs. Also childcare. I think this is a huge, huge, huge impediment, mainly for women faculty, having affordable, accessible childcare that is open hours that academics work. So maybe I'll leave it at that and then answer some questions.
It's all very interesting. I mean, since this morning, it was interesting to see the talks, I feel, fell in two categories. There were those who gave us very interesting statistics and told us, you know, this is the state of affairs, which was very interesting to see the trends across the globe. And then there were those, especially the last one we had before the panel session, that really shared with us the successes and the best practices and so on and so forth. What I, across the morning, what really took me by surprise was that on the one side you have all these measures that we're putting in place that we're trying to, you know, address this challenge, and then you have the numbers. I think the latest one of Dr. Rodriguez was his percentage of increase was 32% to 36%. But similarly, I think earlier this morning we talked about how numbers had risen but had not risen up to the expectations that we had. My question to you, and really whoever wants to answer it, if it's the three of you, that'd be great, is what are the barriers that are stopping us? I mean, you mentioned, Dr. Tannenbaum, that, you know, you've got some people who say to you, really, is this an issue? I mean, what are you talking about? But what are the real barriers? How come we're not succeeding in going further than that slight rise? And is it because we're just addressing this from a top-down fashion? Are we maybe forgetting the bottom-up way of things? And how do we capture that?
I can speak to this about numbers from our Faculty of Science. So in the last 15 years, the number of full professors has increased from about 3% to about 17%, which is great. But if you look at the pipeline, I hate to use that term, but I will, if you look at the pipeline of assistant professors, it's remained steady. And this gets to a question I had asked earlier for the person from the DFG, and it's not just Germany, it's certainly Canada, US, everywhere, that we're just not getting women into these positions, these assistant professor positions. And I think there are systemic impediments to that. Work-life balance is one of these. Childcare is one of these. And if women are not choosing those careers, you're never going to get parity at the full professor level. And if you don't have a high number of people at the full professor level, you won't get people into the leadership positions. And we see this at UBC very starkly with racialized faculty, that we don't have nearly enough in the full professor level, and so we don't see any in the upper administration.
I'll speak similarly. At least in Canada, it's not like there's a new full professor position that opens up every year, especially the ones that are fully paid. And so when you look at changing statistics, you know, it's almost like the retirement has to equal the incoming. Yeah. And there's also been a huge ageist movement, or anti-ageist movement, I should say, in Canada, which is why enforce retirement at age 65. We're healthier than we used to be, and professors are staying in their position longer. So that's actually one barrier. Okay. Interestingly, in the statistics that we've looked at from the Canadian University, what's the CAS survey stand for, which we've only had until 2011 and that's reinstating, the proportion of female assistant professors is at 50% in many universities in Canada. It's the promotion to associate professor, and I know it works differently in Europe and elsewhere, where we start to see the drop off. And of course, you have to decide if you want to apply. Is it because of child leave? Is it because of family caregiving? Is it because a lot of women rightly decide that they do want to stay home for a few years or not miss out? So the tension, I think, at least from the analyses that we've done, is there. What would be interesting to look at, and I don't know these statistics off by heart, is among female professors who apply for promotion, is there a greater rate of refusal? In other words, what are the success rates among those who apply for promotion? So is it, like I showed in my slide this morning, are fewer female professors applying, or are the success rates lower? And if we really want to tackle that question, then I think we have to do an analysis, or maybe somebody knows the answer, but I haven't done that deep dive on a university level.
I have my own.
Oh, right. I took yours. Right, sorry.
Can I pick up on that last point? So I think universities are starting to look at that recruitment process very carefully. And it's a question about numbers, and it's a question about the culture. And then trying to make also the point that although big aggregate figures are not changing fast or fast enough, there are changes, and that's why we need sophisticated, detailed analysis, diving down into the numbers to see where it's going wrong and where it needs to be redressed. So now the example, if you want to hire an assistant professor or equivalent of what that is in Europe with all its different terminology, you have to know what your applicant pool is. That's what you're fishing from. So if you're not getting enough applicants, you know, and you can tell to departments and faculties, you know, we know more or less what the graduation, PhD, postdoc population is and what the representation of women is in your field discipline. And you don't look at aggregates. You look at the field that you're trying to hire in. And you say, okay, you must have at least so many applicants for this position. If you don't have that, you're doing something wrong. Go back. And you need the leadership to be able to say, go back, do your homework again. And then you look at how many CVs you get, how many shortlist you, how many women on the shortlist, how many women in the interview, how many women get an offer, how many women take the offer. You need to have the numbers of all of those to understand what is going on in the process, to really understand what is going on in order to make change. I think that's important.
And in terms of capturing the bottom up, you've answered a bit about the barriers, but I'm really conscious about this bottom up phenomenon. Is there a way of capturing the will of faculty themselves, or of initiatives, or of people? I mean, everything you mentioned all seems so very top down, and I'm just wondering, you know, to what extent is there a way of, someone mentioned earlier this morning that the women networks and so on and so forth. How do we facilitate that those debates, those recommendations, those best practices that maybe don't occur at governance level make their way up to governance and then have an impact?
So I want to address one point that I meant to comment on earlier, because we all want to track. And I think that's part of being able to do these assessments. But there's a danger in that if you're trying to look at an applicant pool and identify who's a man, who's a woman, there's an inherent difficulty in that, because you're deciding for them unless they self-identify. And particularly for people who are coming from countries, applications where you don't necessarily recognize the names. So Jennifer in Western world is recognizable as a woman's name, but that's also suggesting that I identify as a woman. So we're looking at ways to actually try to have applicants identify in different equity groups, and that information would be kept in the dean's offices, and then they would be able to come back to a department and say whether or not your applicant pool was diverse enough. Getting back to the point about bottom up, I think it still has to be top down, because I think the real issue is that if women are not even selecting, like in your analysis, it doesn't appear to be the case if 50% are women in assistant professors. But in our university, it's basically capped out at about 30% for assistant professors in the Faculty of Science. And that includes two huge biology departments, which are often overrepresented. And so I think there have to be some systemic changes at universities to make it more attractive. Frankly, I think we're losing out on a lot of really qualified male applicants as well, who don't want to work in a very breadwinner model university system that requires exorbitant hours, and there's sort of this winner-takes-all type mentality. So I think there have to be, the systemic changes will make it more attractive for coming in from the bottom.
Right. Yes, absolutely.
There was a study recently in the UK by the Royal Society for Chemistry looking at the attractiveness of careers, looking at the PhD, and they found that towards the end of the PhD in chemistry, asking women, are you interested in pursuing an academic career, that dropped a lot more than it did for men. The worrying thing is it also dropped for men, but it dropped so much more for women. So we really have to look into the messages that those women already get about the attractiveness of the university as a place where you want to work. It's not to say that, you know, I understand the difficulties of pursuing an academic career. There are very few academic positions, and we have many more PhDs and postdocs than that we can apply at employ at universities. But the message is also there are many attractive careers outside of the university as well. But let's make sure that we get there with the women and with the men. And my worry is also that we keep some of the best talents within the university, that they don't all leave, you know. And that's also about managing expectations. And it's about giving good career support and development and advice to junior researchers, women and men alike.
Thank you. Okay, so we've got approximately 20 minutes before lunch, and I really like to open the debate to the floor. So we've got a question up here at the front. If you could please state your name and affiliation.
I'm Catherine Waddington, and I'm from the University of Westminster, from the Psychology Department, but I have a background in nursing and healthcare. and nursing is a predominantly female profession. So I'm just interested in your experiences of not all women can be terribly helpful to other women. In nursing, there's a bit of a stereotype. It's a profession that eats its young. So I'm just wondering how you challenge the stereotype of women who've got there. And I've heard women say, and I've got the scars on my back and I'm proud of it. How do we challenge those stereotypes?
So interestingly, the people who have called me aggressive and pushy have been female superiors, which is really interesting, right? Because nobody said assertive, determined, and effective. They said aggressive and pushy, although I think it characterizes the same quality, and yet it's the women who've told me to back off. So again, this is the gender continuum, right? These are women with balls. These are women who embody and possibly identify with that very authoritative, typically male persona, who is tough, strict, no nonsense, and I don't want to say gives you shit if you deserve it. I'm sure that's not politically correct, but that's what it is, right? And the rite of passage, and if I did it, then you should be able to do it too. But women who succeeded, unfortunately, in that era, did have to make choices that perhaps would not be the choices that we would want available to women today. And so the sacrifice culture, the who I had to become culture, and there are women who aren't like that too, who say to me, like, honestly, what's the big deal? I'm 65, I'm sitting at this table, I've always been fine, I get along with all the guys, I could shoot the shit back at them. And you know, I'm thinking of this one in particular. She says, you know, I go out and I drink beer with them all the time. And I said, but you're Irish. And she said, yeah, I had drinking contests with my brothers all the time. Well, I'm not a beer drinker. And I actually don't go out and drink beer after work because sometimes I don't like where the conversation goes. And I'm actually not comfortable with that. She was. So I said to her, her name is Morag, and she'd be happy if I told the story, you know, Morag, do you consider yourself female gender or male gender most of the time? And she thought about it. And she said, I guess I really self-identify with a male gender. So again, what I mentioned about stereotypes and sex versus gender, I think is really interesting. When I give my talk to universities about those letters of reference, someone always asks, so what do you want me to do when I write a letter of reference? Should I not say that this woman is collaborative and caring? I mean, I think it's a great thing, and I think that I should be able to write that about her. Why are those feminine characteristics looked down upon? This is not gender transformative. Dr. Tannenbaum, so what do you want me to do? And you know, I don't think I have the best answer. I think my best answer is that maybe it's okay if you write those words as long as you also say outstanding and cutting edge and productive, because we haven't changed the culture yet. And your point about driving it bottom up, it hasn't been effective. So you need the top down and the bottom up. I wish I had a better answer for you. Patience. I'm patient, and I hope that those people leave and other people come in too, but it's tough. I said to her, I actually said, look, you're an alpha female, Jane, you know, so, you know, I get it. You're an alpha female. You have to be that way. But, you know, honestly, we shouldn't be talking that way. We should be more open. So you have to call people. That's what I mean by calling people on it.
Can I just add, it's okay to be an alpha female, alpha man, beta, whatever. The thing is that you shouldn't let it get in the way of how you work. So that's why it's important that institutions de-bias themselves.
We have a question right at the back. Yes, you, actually, if you could please state your name and affiliation. Thank you.
Singer from Case Western Reserve University in the United States. And I just wanted to call out two issues that have come up. In the United States now, there's much more of a movement towards non-tenure track, contingent faculty, possibly due to the recession, other things. But we have found, we've been tracking for years and years because we had an NSF grant in 2003 and we've been doing programming ever since. But we're finding that there are fewer women on the tenure track, more, a higher percentage of women on the non-tenure track. And that's really something that we've just come to realize. And it may be because they're choosing this, but we also think it's related to the bias of hiring and what we're doing with recruitment. And the second thing is, there's a recent article in the American Psychologist where a group of researchers analyzed why women, apparently women are reluctant to enter kind of the collective anymore, the collective kind of resistance to this issue and the collective affirmation of gender in a way that they haven't in the past. It may be not wanting to be labeled as feminist. I think it's hard for women on campuses to come together, particularly if they're isolated in certain areas. So to me, it's just one of the phenomena. We really haven't made a great deal of progress since the 70s, since Gloria Steinem, in that area where people were really, really active. So.
Okay, so I gather that with comments, thank
yes.
you. I'm going to go here. We've got four tracks, so I'm trying to be equitable. So we're going to go the lady at the front, and then I promise I'll have a look at this side.
I'm Linda Gadech from UC Davis. I have just one comment and then a question.
Okay.
The comment is about a lot of the issues that were brought forward in relation to assistant professors being hired and then being able to move up the ladder and then eventually becoming full professors. We have a presentation today at 2 p.m. where we will show that in the last 5 years on our campus we've been able to really change that, and we have seen almost 48% to 50% participation of women in the assistant professor level, and then almost the same percentage going to associate. And then we saw also tremendous change in the full professor level. So it is possible for change to happen, and I would encourage you, for those who are interested, to come to our presentation. But the one question I have is in relation to gender versus sex. So in the US, for example, in our institutions, we use sex for animals, but we use gender for people. And then maybe we'll use gender and sexuality, that is how we move. We would not use sex for obvious reasons. And if we were to introduce, so I was very interested in finding out that that has already been talking about culture, of course, and what is acceptable, you know, in a given culture. And I was very interested in seeing that in Canada, for example, then there is this differentiation. So I just wanted to ask whether in other places the use of sex together with gender is acceptable, because I think on our campuses would have been a major issue in relation to that.
Maybe Dr. Mace could answer from a European perspective, or I'm just thinking.
To us it's quite clear. I mean, this is not just a Europe or US thing, I think. It's in terms of the research literature, it's quite clear that we need to distinguish between sex and gender, one as a biological and the other as a social construct.
Okay.
I've been told, I mean, there's no issue in Canada writing sex or gender. There's been a lot of awareness raising around that, and I think people, I mean, what we're actually recommending for the national census now is at least a two-part question where we ask what was the sex assigned to at birth and what is your current gender identity. So we've really, really moved there. I told you I've been working with research ethics boards. There have been complaints to research ethics boards when you're asked, are you male, female, and there's no other option. So especially in the transgender community, we have a bill about transgender rights on the table in Canada. We do have a very progressive government. There's huge sensitivity around this. That being said, I was speaking at an ethics conference maybe last month, and an ethicist from a children's hospital stood up and said, but you know, the parents really aren't comfortable if we ask the children, what's your sex? You know, so we say, what gender are you? But they mean sex. And, you know, should we be saying the word sex to kids? And I think I was kind of politically incorrect. I probably just rolled my eyes again. I have to be very careful about this stuff. And I just said, so what do you want to do? Ask them if they have a vagina or a penis? That at least is sex. That's biology. That's anatomy. Like, they all know that. That's okay. But I've been told that it has to do with Rome in Europe, and a lot of the religion, and that's why they don't like using the word sex, and that's why the word gender is always used. I don't know if that's true. I know that the US, I mean, I'm good friends with Janine Clayton, who runs the Office of Women's Health Research at the NIH, and she's very regretful that they've only chosen sex as a biologic variable in their research applications, and they don't ask about gender, but she's had to introduce that under the reproducibility policy, which is mostly animals. At our conferences, we've even started talking about animals having gender because they actually respond to female and male research assistants differently. So we've pushed the limit. I think that that if this audience would consider proper use of the term sex and gender, it's now in the SAGER guidelines. We're asking journal editors to do this. The European Science Association of Editors has endorsed this. Then maybe this is an opportunity to get everyone on the same page, use the same words. And it's very, very helpful in conversations. It's become like a wonderful around my decision-making table, around the board, where they actually correct each other now. Like, don't say a straw man, it's a straw person. And you said gender, do you mean sex? And Kara's going to get angry at you. And don't talk about gender composition of the committees. Talk if there's an equal number of male and female participants. And so it's become this like almost fun competitive thing. And I would say that's been part of the culture change in Canada too, using the correct word. It's scientific.
Can I sneak in really quickly? I just wanted to mention to the person in the back who had asked was asking a question about why haven't we progressed since Gloria Steinem. I read something recently that was about benevolent sexism versus, I forget what the other word is. Does anybody know that, if you know what I'm talking about? That oftentimes, if you're in a society that's particularly misogynistic, women try to protect the status quo because the benevolent sexist will protect them. Whereas if you start to break out of those traditional roles, then you're targeted. And so I have a feeling that it relates to that, actually.
Okay. We have a question on this side, the lady with the glasses on her head. If you could, sorry, it was just easy to find you. If you could please state your name and your affiliation.
Okay, glass is not on the head anymore. So E.T. Richardson from the University of Limerick in Ireland, and I've just found the whole morning so interesting, so thank you very much. I'm going to challenge two stereotypes, and the first one is, I'm a non-drinking Irish woman. Okay. Second one is on the idea of the aggressive woman that's at the top. We always talk about the aggressive woman that's at the top. What about the aggressive men? And a former colleague of mine, Dr. Dervilney Carhaig, when I was a much younger researcher, said one day that the definition of equality is when we have as many incompetent women at the top as we have incompetent men. And I really, really, that has stuck with me, and that is the way I look at things. So I do like to challenge the idea that the women at the top are aggressive. There are odd women that are aggressive, and we pick up on them. And that's our mistake. So I wanted to also go to your bottom-up idea. So I suppose we have looked at gender research over the years where it was change the women. And now we've shifted, thankfully, to change the organization. But I think there is a meeting of the waters. And in the University of Limerick, and Mary beside me has been very, very responsible for a lot of the mentoring work we're doing, for example. So what we are finding is that women aren't actually going for promotion as they should do, or as the men are. But what we've done is we've instigated institutional things where we're changing the institution, putting in mentorship programs, leadership programs, and trying to get the balance so that while we're changing the promotion policies to suit the male-female, the language, the biases, all these things, we're also still working with the women to say, you've got to, you know, even if you don't reach those 10 points and you're reaching 9 of them, you've got to go for it. So it's a case of we shouldn't flip, I think, too far to the other side. It's still got to be a bit of both, because our environment hasn't changed, our society hasn't changed, and we need to make those allowances along the way. Thank you.
Thank you. We have 4 minutes left. Do you have comments to make, or do I take one last question? Okay, so the desperate hands up. Okay, I'll take that lady at the front. It's the final question before lunch, but thankfully we have a long lunch, so you'll be able to ask all the other questions to our speakers then.
Your name and affiliation, please.
My name is Hanneke Teckenberg. I'm from the Erasmus University in Rotterdam, the Netherlands. I work in cardiac surgery. I'm a professor of cardiac surgery. I'm also chief diversity officer at my institution, where only 10% of full professors are female. And when I took on this job 2 years ago, one of the deans told me, well, you know, women are physically not capable of becoming a professor. It's too hard on them. So I laughed, but he wasn't laughing, and his staff wasn't laughing either. And I think that's key of the question that you were actually asking is, so how do we make the leadership support this agenda? And actually, that's the reason why I'm here, so I'm not going to answer that question. I do think that it has to do with the definition of excellence, and I would like to have your view on that. I think right now it's all about individual excellence, which is pretty unidimensional. And I think that what I would call inclusive excellence would be the way to go. But I'd like to hear your thoughts about that.
Could I please ask you in turn to maybe answer that and make the most of wrapping up so that we have your concluding comments. Professor Love, would you like to start?
Sure, I agree completely. I think that the way funding bodies are going now and funding opportunities seemingly internationally are much more about collaborative grants than individual grants. And so that has to be part of that. And if you're able to be part of a bigger team and inclusive, then you'll be more successful in that area. I think, you know, there's some people who will just be knuckle draggers. I don't know if anyone reads The Guardian, but there's this quote from Vladimir Putin about how he has no bad days because he's not a woman. I think he needs gloves to protect his knuckles from dragging. So there are some people you'll never get to, but I think it has to, calling people out on that and the more data you have to show for it, the better. And even using the very old-fashioned metrics for excellence, I think you can disprove him.
Thank you.
I guess I would say good for you, and congratulations for being here. You know, if it were me, I don't know if you've been following the Women Surgeon campaign, where there's four women putting their hands in. I mean, are those pictures that should be up at your university? I've been to Erasmus. It's an amazing university, and you have a lot of female cardiologists. Can you enlist the help of your colleagues? And if all else failed, I might do my next grand rounds on the physiology and science of females as surgeons versus those of males, and statistically show, based on evidence, why there's no difference between the capability of female anatomy and physiology towards male-female anatomy and physiology for being a surgeon. And of course, I would populate it with other things, but it's like I think you said, or some, I think you said, Jennifer, show them the data and make them come out realizing that based on facts, that's simply not true. And my third piece of advice, depending on the context, and I struggle with this, I've been sexually harassed, I've had to call out men, I mean, we haven't been talking about that a lot, but if you get those people alone in the right circumstance, what I have said in the past, and not always, but I have said it many times, is that's just not okay to say that anymore. You know, maybe when you trained and, you know, 50 years ago when you were going through school, it was considered a joke or people laughed when you said things like that. But you are not going to believe how much society has changed. And not only is that offensive, but it's no longer true. And I'm not going to go so far as to say we can make gender bias complaints because, you know, I wouldn't want to do that to you. But I think I would just strongly encourage you to change your language, because I'm doing you a favor by mentioning this to you right now when so many other people are going to be thinking the same way. So you can't say that in front of others. You can, but it might, you know, I've said it in private and it's worked very, very, very well for me. I've also just said I'm really uncomfortable with you commenting on my clothes and not looking at my eyes when you talk to me, and I'm not going to be able to work with you on this paper if we don't establish some level of professionality in our working relationship. So I've said that. Does it always work? No. But does it work a lot of the time? Yeah. So I guess that's my personal advice as well as kind of the institutional way of addressing this.
Thank you.
I think that's very good advice. I hope you can take it up. Excellence is an often misused word, and it means all kinds of things. And it's misused to the sense that people say, well, we know excellence when we see it. And that is also not good enough anymore. That's why it's important to have data and to have evidence and to show it. And one final thing about inclusive excellence, I'm not sure what that means. And I think, as with all buzzwords, it risks being misunderstood. Certainly at the European policy level, I've seen this word now around, and it could be a not so healthy way of introducing all kinds of measures which will actually detract from our quest for excellence. So I think we need to really talk about what excellence is, what meritocracy is. I completely agree that meritocracy is you know, we as universities, we believe that is all what it's all about, and that's what we do. And to confront people by saying, this is not really a meritocracy. There's this and that wrong. That's a hard message, but it's one that you have to bring.
Thank you very much. On that note, could I please ask you to, for a round of applause, to thank Professor Love, Professor Tannenbaum, and Professor Mace.